Live from the On Air Media Studios in Dallas, Texas, welcome to Soundbites with Susan and Waylon, where we take a short extraction of our daily lives as publicists to share with you all. My name is Waylon Tate with J. Waylon & Associates.
And I'm Susan Friedman with Friedman Marketing and Public Relations.
Okay, apparently it was a good week for you.
It was. Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Monday to you.
I know. Happy Monday to you. God, Susan, I feel like it was a blur, right? So we just saw each other.
We did. Well, we saw each other on Saturday.
Yeah.
We had a working brunch at Zephyr's on Saturday morning at 10 a.m.
It was a good one. And we both have a fine appreciation for that space.
Mm-hmm.
It's in our neighborhood. So if you've never been to Zephyr Bakery Cafe, check it out. It's like every time I walk in, I feel like I'm not on the strip anymore, right? I'm not
right.
on Cedar Springs because it's kind of an eclectic kind of place and it feels very European to me.
And every single dish that you order is amazing.
It is. It really is amazing. But we had a really good working lunch. We got a mm-hmm. bunch of stuff worked out.
Well, it's been a little over 3 months since we launched podcast.
That's
so
right.
So we wanted to discuss it, kind of do a quarterly review mm-hmm. and look at our goals and make sure that we're on track.
Yeah, and to really kind of, it's interesting to reflect on how you're doing in front of the camera,
mm-hmm.
retrospectively, because as we've talked about it before, our daily lives is doing that for our clients
mm-hmm.
and seeing, making them see kind of how they do in front of the camera. So it was interesting for that kind of self-reflection, I don't know, but it was good. It was a good working meeting, and it was an eventful weekend, for me, at least.
What did you do?
Well, as we've been talking about on the show, mm-hmm. I'm in the process of buying a house, and so I went and saw a couple
update.
More. Yes, house update. And I have to tell you guys, it's a much more daunting experience than I thought it was going to be. I really had this completely naive, idea that it was going to be very la-di-da, and I was going to be so excited and motivated. And it's the more you see, the more you're like, okay, but I like the elements of this house, but I want to attach those to this one.
Do you think we're going through a housing bubble, like a smaller scale than?
Yes, and I'll tell you why. Because there's actually not that much on the market. Mm-hmm. There really isn't. I've seen probably to date, and Marcy Millard, my amazing realtor, is probably at the point of ready to kill me. She's coming to the coming to Jesus moment talk with me of you've got to settle in the area that you want to go into.
But do it on Facebook Live, it'll be nicer.
But I've seen, 14, 15 houses now, and mm-hmm. I'm trying to get over my separation anxiety from uptown, or the Cedar Springs, Oaklawn area. And I'm much more willing to kind of move outside of the bubble, I think, now.
Right.
But there's really not a lot of properties on the market.
I mean,
honestly, and with the influx of people coming in, they're just snapping them
up
and paying cash.
I wish you luck.
Well, thank you very much. What about you? I saw some awesome pictures of you.
Yes, I went to the Texas Rangers game. It was a lot of fun. I went with my college roommate.
And your husband. Let's not forget
your husband. And my husband and her husband, yes. And so, unfortunately, the Texas Rangers did not win.
Oh.
But we had a great time.
There you are.
Yes, and I even had a Texas Rangers t-shirt on.
Good for you. Yay. I've never been. Girlfriend of mine just happens to know a whole lot of sports figures, and so she invites me often to, Cowboys games and, Mavs and all this kind of stuff, but I can't do it. I'm just not a sportsy kind of person.
Yeah. I do, of course, I talk about it all the time. I'm more into the arts, mm-hmm. but yeah, I try to support the teams every once in a while.
I'll support them from a distance at home. I'll support them through supporting you.
Excellent. So this is the event that I wanted to go to, and I didn't make it, but I stalked everyone on Facebook and Instagram. Easter in the Park, in our neighborhood, Turtle Creek. It was the Easter in the Park and Pooch Parade, and I love looking at all the little puppies because I don't have one now. So
that is
Steve Kemble. We had him on the show earlier. And can I tell you, I saw a picture of that person several times before I knew
realized
that,
that it was Steve.
I didn't recognize him.
He is so hilarious. I wish I had 1/100th of his energy.
Yes.
But it was, so did you drive by at all?
No,
Oh,
here's
look
some
at
more
that.
Pictures.
Cute.
So cute. I tried to pull a few more pictures. And everybody gets dressed up, or a lot of people do. Aren't they cute?
Oh, that is so cute.
So this is what I was thinking.
Because
you are single, you need a dog.
Oh, no.
And you need to go to these pooch parades, you need to walk on the Katy Trail with a really cute dog, and I think that you may meet somebody else who likes dogs and is a good person, and I think it would be a wonderful thing.
Okay.
That, as your publicist, I recommend that you get a dog.
Well, if it's going to increase
a
my
good
chances,
pet owner too.
I would. So what I'm thinking owner. Is, Susan, let's just let's maybe if I get 5 dogs, then it'll exponentially, you know, provide the opportunity for me to find my significant other.
Yeah.
You think so? Or
no.
10?
No.
That'd be overkill.
No. They'll think you're like crazy cat lady.
No, but it's funny because like sometimes you use friends' dogs, and you're right, it's so attractive. Like when I go to lunch with my friend Tracy, and he brings his dog along, it's like everybody stops to look. And so maybe you're right.
Yeah.
Would that be bad for me to just have a dog to find a partner?
No, you love. Do you like dogs?
No, I do. I do. Yeah. I'm just never home, so I feel like it's. You know, it would be.
So you need a small dog that you can bring with you.
Yeah, in my.
And
clutch.
I know somebody who can give you tons of advice, and she's on next.
Okay. Oh yes.
So, and yes.
Would give us some amazing treats, right, for said dog.
Yes.
So what else is going on, Susan?
So we have some future events coming up. And these are the ones that I'm really excited about. And this has actually been going on the first Monday of every month, and I just now found out about it. And it's the Angelica Film Center, and they have throwback to the 80s, and they're doing all these great 80s flicks that like Breakfast Club and all that stuff. So tonight they actually have the Princess Bride. Isn't that great?
Yes.
Its tickets are $12, and they do it the first Monday of every month. So go look at the schedule. I think it's angelicafilmcenter.com.
Okay.
And it has maybe 6 months worth of First Monday films. So put it on your calendar.
No, for sure. I need to be more artsy as well.
Yes. So the next thing that I think is really cool, getting us outside of Dallas, kind of.
I'm all about it.
And it's an owl prowl. That's hard to say.
Owl prowl.
Guided night hike in the Trinity River Forest. How cool is that?
Okay, now you got me working out, Susan.
Well, I didn't realize there were that many owls in Dallas. But did you know that Dallas has the largest urban forest in the entire country?
Where?
The Trinity River area, the Trinity Forest. So yeah, I think it sounds really neat. And the night ends with s'mores, and that's one of my favorite desserts of all time, which you told me about the...
Yes, Jeffrey Collinger's tableside s'mores.
Anyway, this event is on Thursday. Tickets are $15 in advance online at trinityriver.audubon.org.
Okay.
Or they're $20 at the door. So get out of the city and into nature with owls.
An experience, because we get so like wrapped up in the... Well, I know our lives are like always inside the city, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of like this like 1 mile radius of just event after event after event. And so you're right. It's nice to kind of sometimes look outside.
Brian and I try to go hiking to Dinosaur Valley and stuff.
Where are these places? I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh my God, you have got to get outside of Dallas.
It's like from my condo to Starbucks to work here.
Whole Foods.
It's like,
Yes.
But no, I do. I need to get outside. That's why I'm single, Susan. Like, not to, keep bringing it up, but it's because I don't cook, so I'm not going to meet somebody, at the vegetable aisle, right? And I don't really do anything except for work, and work. So, and teach.
Yeah, we need to, that's not a healthy lifestyle.
I know.
But it's, okay.
Okay, Mom.
Oh, yeah. Okay, and then finally this weekend, it's one of my favorite events of the year. It is the 24th annual Deep Ellum Arts Festival.
Oh,
yay. Yes. It's Friday through Sunday, and it's not only visual arts and fine arts, but it is also musicians. They have like 4 stages, over 150 different musicians, soloist bands, what have you.
This I'm actually
and
going
over
to.
200 art vendors participating. A lot of them are painting live, so it's really cool. If you haven't been, you need to go.
No, this one I am for sure going
to. It's free.
Yeah, it
it's
is.
It's free. So go to deepellumartsfestival.org or com. Let me see. .com.
And check it out. No, I'll be. Are you going to go?
I want to.
Okay.
Well, I wonder what the weather's like.
I don't know. Well, we'll have to meet up there. And
it is outside. So it's like 6 blocks long, I think.
Yeah, it's big.
Yeah.
It's really big. And there's going to be a lot of talented people there. So I'm for sure going to go check that out. So what's going on in the news?
Okay. So I feel like I'm a wealth of information. I'm your encyclopedia.
You are. Yeah, this is kind of how the show works. So.
Okay. So I was reading... Always before our show, I kind of do public relations. I Google that and look at news and see what's kind of going on in our industry. And I thought this was really interesting. It was actually in a college newspaper at Texas State University. And their PR class is promoting the legalization of marijuana for their class project.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think that it's going to be interesting. Obviously, mm-hmm. I know a little bit about public policy.
I have
a master's in public policy, and I teach a federal mm-hmm. government class, and I've continued to tell my students, mm-hmm. this is going to happen, mm-hmm. people. I mean, it's inevitable, mm-hmm. right? And, you know, I try to give all of the information on both sides of the equation to be as unbiased as possible. Mm-hmm. But the reality of the situation is, it is happening already. And I think that the less we try to moralize the laws that we have, right, mm-hmm. the better it is for everyone, because you're able to tax that. And if you could use Colorado as a case study,
right,
to tell you about how much money you can raise and what you can do with that. And most of the time, with the states that have already kind of adopted policies towards legalizing marijuana, they earmark the tax money, meaning it's going to go specifically to public education, mm-hmm. or veterans affairs or what have you. And
got
so,
it.
But, you know, kind of back to a PR angle of this, mm-hmm. I think it's going to be interesting to see, and I really want to go see, like, what they're,
like, what angles
they're
talking
about.
I do too. I want to see their final campaign project and how it influenced their community.
Right. But it's certainly a progressive piece of legislation. Mm-hmm. But right now, there is bipartisan support, even in the Texas House.
Really?
For this, yeah, it's going to make it out of committee if it hasn't already. Because people at some point just realize, even in our own city, Sudan, mm-hmm. we kind of enacted what's called stop and release, or something like that. First come release, stop and release. But basically, cite and release. So if you get caught by a regular officer for a right. small amount of marijuana, mm-hmm. they're not going to arrest you. They're going right. to issue a ticket and send you on your way.
I have a question.
Sure.
So can police detect people driving under the influence of marijuana?
Can they
detect? Like, because it obviously slows down your mm-hmm. response time. Mm-hmm. So is it legal to drive under the influence of marijuana?
No. It's not legal to drive under the influence of anything, including prescription drugs or anything else. Mm-hmm. The way the law defines it, oh God, my own attorney out there is like, he's going to butcher this. But in essence, anything that would inhibit your natural ability to mm-hmm. Operate a motor mm-hmm. vehicle.
Right.
That's kind of the way that it's laid out. So, yeah, I mean, I can't imagine that there's been any cases at all of someone being in a vehicular, you know, accident based on smoking pot, because I mean, what, you're driving 20 miles an hour, maybe. I mean, eating Cheetos. I mean, I don't know. But I'm right. obviously.
That's the only thing that I was kind of concerned about, is because, yeah, I mean, and I should probably clarify, this is about medical marijuana, just not
sure.
marijuana, this class project, which I don't know if that makes a difference or
it
not.
It does. It makes a huge
and
difference.
And so I do want to clarify that in case I just said marijuana.
Okay. Well, I'm going to call one of the students and I want to get their positions.
Yeah, you should.
Maybe I could give them some free,
I think it was interesting.
Offer some help. Being on the inside.
I think you should.
Yeah, I think I should.
Okay, and then I also wanted to let you know I'm applying for a job.
Oh God, here we go.
In LA. It's with Netflix. They're looking for a publicist for a salary of $400,000.
Including options.
Plus options, yes.
Oh my gosh. That's a good salary.
Yeah.
That's a good salary.
Yes, and there's actually 50 marketing and PR jobs available at Netflix. And what I have learned, I'm not involved that much in the Hollywood industry, but Netflix is blowing it out with their competitors as far as salaries in all different categories. And their competitors can't keep up with them right now and are actually complaining because producers are now headed over to Netflix. Netflix is rocking it, though. They're doing something right, I guess.
And I'm
right?
interested to hear why you think that is, because I have my own kind of interpretation of mm-hmm. why Netflix is doing so well. And mm-hmm. I think it's because they were ahead of the curve with direct mm-hmm. services, right? Mm-hmm. To where people want to do things. We live in a crazy busy world. Mm-hmm. And I think we're just moving into an opportunity where people want to watch what they want to watch when they want to watch it. And so I think that, you know, Netflix, again, they picked up on this and they said, why do we need to hold people back and make them watch something every week when we can just give them all 12 or 18 episodes and they watch it at their leisure?
Right.
Right? Whatever it is, it's working for them for sure.
Yeah.
They're about to invest $20 million. They're hiring 50 publicists at $400,000 apiece. I mean, something's, what would that
Well, their sales are projected to be $15.8 billion. Now, one of their competitors, CBS, is their revenue is $14.5 billion. That's $1 billion difference.
Jesus.
I know, they're doing something right.
What do you think the responsibility
is? But they're also not doing the news, so they don't have to hire the staff and labor to
That's
do
right.
news.
They just have to get...
And that is expensive, and we appreciate it. I love the news.
Yes, I love the news as well. Awesome. Okay, well, I think we are ready for a quick break with our sponsor, Crudo Vodka. And when we return, you guys, get ready. It's going to be so exciting.
Yes.
If you are a lover of dog, you're going to be a lover of our next guest. So we'll see you in just a few. Welcome back.
Hey, we're here. And today we have our special guest. We have Kameron Westcott. A lot of people know her as one of the Real Housewives of Dallas. And we're going to find out so much more of what she does. And thank you. We all wore pink.
Just for you, Kameron.
I feel so at home with all the pink. It just makes me so happy. Oh, my gosh. I love it. And I love the pink on the flowers.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And thank you for having me. This is so exciting to
be here. We're so excited to, I mean, you know, obviously Susan and I run in some social circles here, and so I've seen you at events. We've never had the opportunity to meet, but what I love is that you're doing so much more than just what people see
Thank
on the
you.
Show, in really good ways, right? And
yes, it's more than pink.
That's
what I
always
say. There's more than pink to me.
So tell us a little bit about Sparkle Treats, because we all know that you love dogs and you've created this brand because of that.
Yes.
So tell us, what is kind of its separation of difference?
Yeah, you know, Louie and I just were walking up and down the aisles at local pet stores, and we were just so sick of looking at all the boring dog food brown bags and boring dog food. And to be honest, you know, healthy food is extremely important. It's our number one. But Louie was also just bored of the taste, and he really wanted something that was exciting to eat and that mommy loved as well.
Okay.
And you know, I started Sparkle Dog just to make him happy. He wouldn't eat at the house. He would never eat unless I hand fed him. So I had to develop something that he was happy eating. And I really, of course, wanted to also incorporate something that really touched my heart, which my girlfriend actually was diagnosed with breast cancer 3 years ago.
Okay.
And I saw what she was going through and the battles that she was facing. So it was extremely important for me to incorporate an organization that was important to me. So I ended up partnering with Susan G. Komen with my Sparkle Dog food. And we mixed pink heart-shaped kibbles within our food, which is more than pink when there's pink heart-shaped kibbles.
Yeah.
And that represents women battling breast cancer.
That's right.
So that's so important to me. And of course, I'm a huge pink lover. So it also made sense for us to, you know, partner. But you know, my other thing is, why would you want brown stink when you can have sparkly pink?
Yes,
I mean,
agreed.
So I have a bunch of questions for you. So, I mean, this is a whole new, innovative way of thinking into a traditional dog food brand. How has that been? I mean,
extremely hard.
Yes.
Extremely hard. I can't tell you. When I started out, I called 30 different factories around the United States. Only one was willing to work with me. They all thought I was prank calling them when I said I wanted to mix in pink shaped heart kibbles. They were like, what are you talking about? They thought I was, you know, pranking them.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, this is serious. I really want to do this. And I just feel like the dog industry is, they're just so close-minded in a lot of different ways. And they weren't ready to accept this new form of dog food. They were not. And a lot of people think, you know, why put pink heart-shaped kibbles in there? Well, it's representing women battling breast cancer, and that is so important. So there's more than pink, and a lot of people that don't know that I'm partnered with Susan G. Komen, they look at the pink-shaped heart kibble, and they're just like, this girl's crazy. She is just a pinkaholic spreading more pink around the world. But it means so much more than just pink. Yeah. So once people, you know, really research the brand and understand what's going on, then they're like, this is amazing. I want to be a part of this.
I love that.
So you actually just went to an expo in Orlando. It was called the
Global Pet Expo. Global Pet Expo. One of the biggest world trade shows for the pet industry.
Yeah. And so you participated as a vendor, correct?
Yes.
And how, so that was probably a huge introduction. Was this your first expo?
It was my first expo ever. I mean, it was huge. It was so exciting. I mean, I'm telling you, the minute we popped up the booth, everyone, you know, started gathering. I mean, they just had so much fun researching and learning about our brand.
Oh my God, that's amazing. Did, so you literally show up, right, to this expo. And you, oh my God, there's a picture, you guys. Is
that's
that not
Louis,
the cutest?
Right?
Louis, that's when Louis. He had his really short hairdo. We've been growing it up, by the way. So he has more of a beard and a lion cut.
I love it. Yes, oh, and here you are. Is this at the expo?
Yes, it's at the expo. So yes, and you know, we just did the small startup booth because, you know, I am a startup company. This is the start of it. So we did our 10 by 10, which is the smallest booth you can get at Global Pet Expo. And it was the perfect size because everyone could come mingle and, you know, learn about our brand.
Yeah.
And you know, it was just so exciting to be there. And I just had chill moments every moment I was there. And it went by so fast. It was 3 full days. And I couldn't tell you how many amazing products there are out there for the in the dog industry, though. I mean, animal lovers, everyone was there. We had animal lovers, we had dog bloggers. The dog bloggers would be walking around and then they Instagram your product if they like it. Mm-hmm. And you know, you have to be on good behavior for the dog bloggers to come over. And you just hope they you know, post about your brand. It's amazing.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And so, I was working with dog bloggers.
And how did you find out about it? Did you know that, was that part of your, do you have a business plan and that was part of your business plan?
Yes, it was part of my business plan 100%. And you know, after talking to a lot of people in the industry, they told me this is where it starts.
Okay.
You need to go to global, meet everyone in the industry. This is where the big retailers come to start spotting their products.
Sure.
And this is where they do most of the buying, and this is where the distributors pick up their new products. And, you know, my goal going was to get a distributor and to start, you know, getting people to distribute my food nationwide.
Okay.
I'm currently on Amazon, so I could ship nationwide.
Okay.
But I really wanted to be with a distributor because that's a big deal in this industry.
Yeah.
Sure.
That is
so.
So I'm just curious if, so the people that came to the expo as guests, I guess, were mostly buyers and things of that nature.
Yes.
Did they know who you were, like, outside of?
It's funny. There was a lot of buyers that came up to me that actually do watch the show.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And they were very aware of my brand and they could not believe that it was here. They were like, this is amazing. We are so excited you did this. You know, kudos to you. We're rooting for you. And they all were so supportive. And it was just great hearing that feedback from them. And, you know, I, of course, am so new to this industry. I'm learning so much as well.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
So I was just getting as much feedback as I could and, you know, getting everyone's advice. I have been in the industry for years and years. Mm-hmm. And it really helped a lot to be there.
So awesome.
That is great. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's exciting.
I know.
So I was reading your bio and I saw that you actually in the past was a fashion designer, at least in the fashion industry, for dog.
Yes, dog, for dog clothing.
Oh. So is that SparkleDog? Is that, because it's not SparkleDog food, it's SparkleDog, kind of like a brand.
I'm hoping one day to roll that out.
Okay. Yes. I was like, it's the next step.
Yes,
is that perfect?
I know. I'm hoping one day to roll that out for sure. And I had so much fun doing it. And, you know, I ended up starting my dog clothing line. It was called Baby Lou Pooch Couture.
Uh-huh.
And we were just in local stores in Dallas. And then I ended up getting pregnant and I didn't have the time to really, you know, put into the line. And so I kind of put everything on hold and I just never really got back into it.
Sure.
And, you know, it's something I'm going to definitely add on.
I think that's great. And so as we're sitting here thinking, I'm like, obviously, as a publicist, I'm thinking, God, there's so many things we can do. So I have to ask, okay, have you taken the opportunity to send some Sparkle treats to your fellow sister of the Housewives franchise, Lisa Vanderpump, who obviously is very well known for Jiggy, right, her dog.
Yes.
So I didn't know, have you?
Yes, I know. She had placed an order when I first came out. And
I love
she placed
that.
An order and she was so sweet. And So yeah, so they've all had it over there and they've tried it, and I love that, of course. And all my fellow castmates, their dogs have all tried it as well. Mm-hmm. And they all loved it.
Sure.
Every one of them loved it. I've actually only met one dog that has not liked it. Louis, you know, my Yorkie,
yeah.
He nailed the taste. I made him pick out the recipe, and I literally lined every different recipe up, and he went to the one he wanted, and he kept going back to the same one.
And you trusted his judgment.
Trust his judgment. He's my business partner.
I love that.
So you can't be in the dog industry yeah. without having a dog business partner, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it just doesn't
That's
make
right.
sense.
Aww. That's right.
So, and he, I'm telling you, the only one dog has not liked it, and that one dog mm-hmm. eats foie gras. So,
oh.
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
well, I mean, how do you
very,
go from that?
Very high frozen, maintenance dog.
There's
so.
Like, did you know that there's refrigerated dog food
yeah.
now? And like, there's
yes.
all different, yeah, it's pretty, and there's frozen treats and everything.
Yes, like, yes, yeah. yes. So. It's amazing, and I hope one day to go into that as well. And mm-hmm. you know, sure. it was so important to me to keep my price low, of course. And once you start going into all mm-hmm. of that, you know, the price point comes up a lot.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And once I can figure out to get that price point down for the average American to be able to afford that, I'm all in.
I love
I'm
it.
I'm still researching all that, trying yeah, to get that price point down.
I'm sure there's so much to learn, right? And that's
so
you
much.
Said you were a startup, and that's exactly yes. what those kind of fundamental months are for,
mm-hmm.
is to really understand your own business and
right.
kind of how you do the development. And,
yes.
There's a lot of research that goes into
a lot.
It.
And everything's changing so much.
Sure.
You know, a lot of, when I was just at Global, a lot of people are now adding freeze-dried on top of their kibble. So that is something else that we're going to be adding on actually right now.
I don't
now.
Even know what that means.
I know, freeze-dried. I
like,
know.
Do you?
Freeze-dried
okay.
food, it has a lot more protein than a kibble does.
Okay.
So it adds, the protein level goes
it's like
up
a supplement.
Extreme. Yeah, it's a Vitamin supplement to put on top of the kibble. So I know.
Doggy supplements. I love it.
I know.
Okay, I have to transition into it. We promised Cameron we wouldn't inundate her with questions about The Real Housewives, but there was a couple that I was like, I have to know. So, what was your first, what was the experience like the first time that you met Andy Cohen?
Oh my gosh, Andy is amazing. I was shaking when I first met him. I mean, he's like the king of pop culture.
Yeah, he is.
You know, so the fact that I met him, you know, it was just mind-boggling. But, you know, one of the reasons why I wanted to be on the show, of course, was to meet him. I mean, that was
sure.
like one of the bonus perks of it. He is, you know, hilarious, super funny, outgoing. I mean, his energy, just being in a room with him, you know he's in the room.
And he's a workaholic.
Yeah. Oh,
doesn't
yes.
he
workaholic.
Work like...
And he always is so put together and looks like he just came off like a photo shoot.
That's so great.
I don't know how he puts himself together like that. I mean, I'm still learning.
Yeah, it's...
Oh. I'm still learning.
No, you always
oh my
look
gosh.
Fabulous.
No,
oh,
you
you're
really
so
do.
Sweet. Thank you.
You really do.
Oh, gosh. Well, thank you.
So how many times have you visited the... what does he call it? The...
Clubhouse.
Clubhouse. Yes.
Yes. I know. Sometimes I like to call it the treehouse.
Yeah, that's what
I said. But it's called the clubhouse. I've actually gone one time.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm hoping, you know, hopefully I'll get to go again eventually.
Yeah,
so after
you will.
Maybe our... another season down the line.
Yes.
We'll see.
We'll see what happens.
I know.
Cool. And then I'm always interested to know, what is it like having a crew of people following you around? For is it when you film, is it about 3 months?
Yes.
How long is it about?
It's probably around 3 months, but I mean, we could be doing pickups for maybe, you know, a little bit longer sometimes. Just
okay.
kind of depends how fast we get everything done. But yeah, I mean, having so many people in your house, it's a little overwhelming. And there's times where they're just, you know, setting things up and
sure.
I'll be upstairs doing makeup. But you really, you know, you really just get used to it and you don't realize, you know, there's people in your house all the time. You don't realize there's a camera in front of you anymore, which is very scary.
Yeah.
I've
because
heard that.
A lot of
people
get a little too
yeah.
comfortable sometimes, which
sure.
is great. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to, you know, be careful too, because everything you say can offend someone in some way.
That's right.
I mean, that's the thing. Everything can offend someone. I could be wearing this and someone could be offended.
Well,
you know,
because
so.
It's all about, you know, I think that in many ways, reality television looks for those spaces,
mm-hmm.
right? Because it's television, right? And they're
right.
wanting to sell television. But I can certainly understand where that kind of, the veil kind of comes down and you become so relaxed in your own
so
environment
relaxed.
Because it's,
yeah.
it's like a third part of your family, right?
Right,
the addition
right.
to your family. So how often do you, so when we see the testimonials, those are shot after you've kind of wrapped
it's
the show?
During.
Yeah. So they
it's
kind of come
during,
back and forth.
Yes.
I've always wondered
yes,
that.
Just because it's all natural instincts. It's like, is responding to things that happened, you know,
right.
previously. Okay. So it's very close in time, yeah.
And it's just you and the producer, and they're just asking you questions about what they've caught on, on camera.
Exactly, And you just have to, you know, be on. And that's one thing about being on reality TV. You know, you want to always be on, and but sometimes you're not on. And so sometimes you're like half asleep, and you just hope that, you know, you look okay.
Well, you look fabulous on the show, I have to say.
So, and I do want to mention, Kameron and I actually know each other because we're working on an event together. She is the honorary co-chair.
We're so excited.
Thank you for doing this. She's our honorary co-chair for No Tie Dinner and Dessert Party.
That's right.
We actually had the chair, Leslie Fry, on maybe 4 weeks ago. And so it's this Saturday, and we're really excited that you're going to be doing it. So we have an 80s theme. Do you have your outfit?
I'm so excited. I'm going to wear a Barbie 80s outfit.
Oh.
I know. And I'm gonna. It's going to be like a pink corset with like a pink, like a fuchsia, like tutu.
Oh, I love that.
I know. And I'm really excited. I'm getting it handmade by a sweet lady on Etsy who's making it for me.
Oh, that is huge.
Etsy's just amazing for costumes. I mean, there's so many talented designers on there that are just... you know, up and coming that will do things for you. So I'm really excited about that. Right.
And Princess Barbie makeup. Promise me.
100%. I'm going to do the Princess Barbie hair, everything. I'm looking for hot pink high heels right now that are like that perfect hot pink, like this color.
I Googled that as well. They're kind of hard to find right now. I only found one pair, but I didn't buy them, so it's all you.
Oh, my God, you're so sweet. I can't wait to see your outfits.
You got the memo. I know.
Oh, my gosh. I can't wait to see your outfit.
I'm excited. Anyway, so it's this Saturday. If anybody would like to go, it's notiedinner.org. It's for an amazing charity. It's for Aid Services of Dallas, which provides housing and services for those who were formerly homeless who have HIV or AIDS.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah, so it's great. So tickets are still available. They are $75 for general admission, $150 for VIP. You can tell I'm the PR chair for this event.
And VIP, you get lounge seating.
That's right.
You get lounge seating. Oh, and you get full bar. So drinks are actually included in the general admission ticket, but you get a full bar service for your VIP. And with that, I want to toast and say thank you for being on
our
show.
Thank you for having me,
guys. This is the Totally Tubular.
We'll have to bring you back. We're not the clubhouse, but we're a friendly
folks around. Oh, this is fun. Hey, and I have my cocktail, so this is super exciting. It's pink.
It is. It's pink. Just for you. Perfect.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next week on Soundbites with Susan and Waylon.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.